At 5:24 a.m. on the 24th of May 1968, the central part of New Zealand was rocked by a magnitude 7.1 earthquake. It was centred near Inangahua, a tiny rural community on the west coast of the South Island. The earthquake was a big one. Near the epicentre, people were thrown out of bed and had to hastily escape from their homes amidst the chaos of toppled furniture, open cupboards and falling roof tiles. The earthquake woke up people all over New Zealand, but it was half a day before anyone realised where the epicentre was. In Wellington, the recorder at the Seismological Observatory was thrown off scale, splattering ink in the surrounding area, as you can see in the bottom right. As a young geologist, fresh out of university, I was astonished at the force of the earthquake, which was larger than anything I'd ever felt before. I was staying in an old wooden house in Westport, about 50 kilometres away from Inangahua, and I can remember grabbing the side of the bed so that I didn't fall out. The shaking seemed to last for several minutes. Then there was a tremendous crash above my head, which turned out to be the chimney collapsing. In the weeks that followed, I was involved in earthquake investigations and gradually came to realise how widespread the impact of the Inangahua earthquake had been. Inangahua is surrounded by forest-covered hills. The shaking caused huge landslides on the steeper slopes. This image shows the road through the Upper Buller Gorge in the centre, parts of which were wiped out by the landslide. It was many months before the road was open again for traffic. Of immediate concern was the huge landslide in the Buller Gorge, a few kilometres upstream from Inangahua, which temporarily dammed the Buller River. The danger of a dam burst flooding the area downstream led to the evacuation of everyone at Inangahua. Next morning, it was clear that the danger had passed. The river overtopped the dam and cut down through the toe of the landslide without causing a flood. But the landslide can still be seen 50 years later, and there are rapids in the river at this point. There was only a single power line passing through Inangahua, bringing power to industries in Westport, such as the mines and the cement works. Despite the widespread landslides and rockfalls, the lines were unbroken and power was quickly restored. The hills around Inangahua include steep limestone cliffs, which were the source of a huge number of rockfalls and landslides, some of which extended hundreds of metres away from the source area. Two of the three deaths directly caused by the earthquake occurred near White Cliffs, where a house beneath the limestone cliff was destroyed by a rockfall. The inhabitants of the house were unlucky because the rockfall destroyed the house, but the garage a few metres away to the right was undamaged. The remains of the car parked outside the house can be seen in the foreground. A train was passing near Inangahua at the time of the earthquake, and several of the carriages were derailed. Fortunately, the railway from Reefton to Westport was not badly damaged and was reopened within a matter of weeks. We soon discovered a small fault offsetting the railway line near Inangahua Station. It could be traced for several hundred metres and seemed to join up with a fault that had moved many times in the past. Mapping over the next few months showed that several small faults had moved during the earthquake, but we finally concluded that the major rupture that caused the earthquake had not broken the surface. Roads had subsided in many places around Inangahua, but mainly in areas of unconsolidated fill. Some sections of the road had little damage, but others were pockmarked with holes and collapses. It was clear that there needed to be better quality control in road construction. Liquefaction was widespread on some of the flat terraces around Inangahua. It wasn't a major hazard at the time, because there were few houses built on this land, but it was recognised by engineers and geologists that it could be a problem in urban areas built on unconsolidated sediment. Almost all the buildings around Inangahua were single-storey wooden houses with corrugated iron roofs. These houses generally survived the earthquake with little damage. The garage on the left appears to have collapsed because it had no internal bracing. This little wooden church jumped off its piles, moving about a metre to the left, but was otherwise undamaged. These railway houses all had heavy tiles on the roof, many of which were dislodged during the earthquake. Two of the most modern houses in Inangahua had brick veneer over timber framing. The brick veneer cracked badly and the houses were eventually reclad with weatherboard. Note the contrast to the wooden house on the left with a corrugated iron roof which was practically undamaged. The Inangahua earthquake came as a terrible shock. There hadn't been a big earthquake in New Zealand for more than 2 decades, and people had become complacent about the cost and disruption such a disaster causes. Because it occurred in a sparsely populated area, casualties were light, but it acted as a warning to improve our preparation and response to disasters. A lot has changed over the last 50 years, and today GeoNet gives instant information on the location of any earthquake. But although we've learnt a lot more about earthquake science, we still can't predict when or where they will occur. The Inangahua earthquake reminded us about some of the earthquake hazards we face in New Zealand, including landslides, rock falls, liquefaction, and the damage that shaking can cause to buildings. This is why we need to look back 50 years and remember the Inangahua earthquake.